When Horace Greeley said, "Go west, young man," the west he was referring to was wild and untamed and held a fascination for the adventurous soul. There's another legendary west that remains untamed and appeals to the adventurous soul. And the one I'm referring to is known the world over for a breezy, witty kind of sexuality that is her own unique invention. Ladies and gentlemen, the one and never lonely, Miss Mae West. Good evening.
How do you do?
May I call you Mae?
No, of course.
Okay. Mae, one of the first things everybody worried about when you went into movies, of course, was how can they put Mae West on the screen? Did you worry about censorship?
Oh, not exactly. It was my suggestion that they read the script before I shoot the scene. So and that's then, what they did.
And then if they wanted something out, would you talk to them about it or argue
with
them?
Well, I'd take it out, put something else in.
Yeah.
Sometimes I put extra things in that I knew they were going to take out just to make them happy, you know.
One of your co-stars was a man you sort of discovered by looking out a window.
Oh, I was in the office at Paramount, and they gave me a large book with a lot of photographs of different leading men. And I was sitting at a table or a desk right near the window and the door. And after I looked at a few, I kind of glanced out the window, and I see this good-looking guy walk across the street. So I said, "That's about the best looking thing in Hollywood. Who is he?" So they looked and they said, "Oh, that's Cary Grant. We haven't used him in a picture as yet, but we made tests of him with some of the starlets." I said, "Well, if this guy can talk, I'll take him." So they called him in and we met, and he said, "How'd you do?" And I said, "Okay." And they said, "What part?" I said, "The lead, of course." So he got the lead.
All you had to hear was, "How do you do?"
Yeah, the voice.
Have you been friends ever since?
Oh, yes. In fact, I had him twice. I liked him so well, I had him twice. I had him in another picture. Yeah, oh, yes.
I have to watch you because almost everything you say seems to have at least three meanings.
That's my mind.
When you made My Little Chickadee with W.C. Fields, he was quoted as saying, "Somebody stole the cork out of my lunch." Was his drinking a problem?
No, I had, I heard about him, and I had a clause put in my contract that if he stopped drinking or so, to take him off the set.
And what happened?
Well, he was fine for about 3 weeks until we had a scene we were shooting with a lot of extras, you know. And he was on there shooting early in the morning, and I come in around 1 o'clock, found out that he had been drinking. So as soon as I walked in and I took a look at him, I says, "Get him out of here." And they took him out. And after that, we never had any trouble with him.
Those are marvelous looking diamonds. Or I should say, goodness, what wonderful diamonds.
Goodness had nothing to do with it.
One of the things that people tend to forget about you is that you're one of America's most prolific writers. You wrote novels, you wrote plays, you wrote your screenplays. You must have spent a lot of time at the typewriter.
I don't use a typewriter. I can't type now.
Where do you do your work?
You know what I mean, my thinking or?
Yeah, you're writing.
Oh, well, I do that. I do a lot of it in bed, and then I have secretaries that I dictate to.
While you're in bed?
No. After I get out of bed.
You once did a play with a very simple title. You know the one I mean?
Sex?
That's the one.
No one ever. Not so simple.
No, but I mean it's
a one-word title.
That's right.
Yeah.
That must have been quite shocking at the time.
It was. Some of the newspapers wouldn't accept the ad. They put in Mae West in that Satan play. I finished the play, and I didn't put my own name on it. I put Jane Mast.
Why'd you do that?
Well, I didn't want to put Mae West on it, starring Mae West, written by Mae West, Mae West, Mae West, too much Mae West.
Well, you yourself once said too much of a good thing can be wonderful. The play Sex was the one you went to jail for. Did you have to wear prison clothes?
No, not exactly. I didn't wear that burlap underwear. I wore my silk underwear.
Why do they make prisoners wear burlap underwear?
I don't know.
Part of the punishment?
I don't know. I guess they get used to it and they don't mind it. I never heard any complaints while I was there about their underwear.
Once a judge said to you, "Are you trying to show contempt for this court?"
Well, I said, "I'm doing my best to hide it."
Were your parents ever shocked at your behavior?
No. My mother always thought everything I did and said was great. Just...
Are you good in a crisis?
What kind of a crisis?
Any kind. I was thinking of in your book when you mentioned that you've always been good under pressure. Except when your mother died.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was the worst tragedy of my life. I don't ever expect anything to equal that.
Was your mother that much closer to you than your father?
Oh, yeah. My mother. Wonderful woman.
What pulled you out of that depression?
Well, it took time. It took me about 3 years.
Did you think of quitting the business? Was it hard to perform?
No, I went on because I knew she wanted me to, you know.
Did she live to see your great success?
Well, she didn't live to see me in pictures. Mm. But she knew, she always knew that I would be, you know.
Yeah. At age 15, you wrote a poem that wasn't typical for a 15-year-old. It was called Cave Girl. Can you recall it?
Yeah. I got my smile from the sunshine. I got my tears from the rain. I learned to dance when I saw a tiger prance, and a peacock taught me to be vain. A little owl in a tree so high, he taught me how to wink my eye. I learned to bill and coo from a turtle dove, and a grizzly bear taught me how to hug. But the guy that lived two caves from me, he taught me how to love.
One of my favorite lines from your films is when someone says to you, "There are 10 men waiting for you at your apartment." Do you remember what you answered?
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm a little tired tonight. One of those guys will have to go.
When you first came to Hollywood, did you have any rules for preserving yourself? You know what I mean? Surviving? Because a lot of people were destroyed by Hollywood success.
Oh, well, I don't drink and I don't smoke and I never did, never have. And
you don't have any vices?
No, hardly.
You kept a diary of your life?
Oh, yes.
You have?
To a certain extent.
You think everybody should?
Yeah, I figure that you keep a diary, someday it may keep you.
All through your career, you've been a favorite for female impersonators.
Yeah, they give the best imitations of me.
You once did a play on Broadway with a lot of female impersonators in it.
Yeah, The Drag.
The Drag. Well, it was considered quite shocking at the time.
They came to me and asked me to please do not bring that play into New York because we are not equipped.
Yeah.
They figured they'd have a lot of riots and excitement going on. I glorified the homosexual.
The homosexuals are particularly fond of you. Why is that?
Oh, they are. Well, they know what I was doing for them, you know.
Let's make a test. Some years ago, you did an interview that was going to be shown on this network, but they decided it was too racy, mostly because of the question that the man asked you, "Why do you have mirrors on your bedroom ceiling?" Can you remember your answer?
Yeah. I like to see how I'm doing.
Well, if you heard it, things have changed. May I make a deal with you? If we can scare up a few props and put up a little set of some sort, would you evoke some of the magic of the legendary, famous on two continents, notorious Diamond Lil?
Will they allow it?
We'll take a chance.
Oh.
Okay.